Yeah, I thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to be here again for this nice meeting. So we'll go to the very mathematical foundations of. I'm going back to the mathematical foundations of homogenization and present actually two methods to compute the effective second gradient properties of elastic composites. So it is the method of oscillating functions, which was developed by Luc Tartar in the 70s with François Murat, and also a relatively new method that was developed by Sioranescu and co-workers, which is called the unfolding method. And I will compare them, of course, and show that they lead to the same results. And I will make applications to a stratified composite, which is a very good example because we can do 1D homogenization. So there is some tool to switch the jazz, but I cannot find it. Okay. So very shortly, some historical overview of homogenization. Just, of course, it started in the 70s. It was a popular topic to study PDEs with rapidly varying coefficients. So you have some illustration. You know physically what happens. Then it was developed in France. There is an important activity by people like Ben Soussan, Sanchez Palencia in the 80s. Then there was also in parallel activity in Italy under the name of G-convergence for self-adjoint operators, extended to non-self-adjoint operators under the name H-convergence by people like Tartar and François Murat in the late 70s. Periodicity assumptions is not necessarily required, especially for G and H convergence. Then De Giorgi, introduced the gamma convergence, which is similar to G convergence but for functionals. And then there were two scales convergence developed. And considering periodic microstructure, we can notice this works here. And the unfolding method, so is one of the class of methods that was developed in the early 2000 by Sioranescu and Grisot also in Paris 6. Not only in elasticity, in different fields. And of course, more recently, we have also works computing higher order terms in asymptotic expansions, and we saw already some work this morning by people in this room. So I don't know why the bottom is truncated actually. I should have more names coming. Okay, so I will introduce a few reminders, but we would need actually much more time because people in mechanics, maybe they are not so acquainted with functional analysis anymore. It was maybe a popular topic in the 80s, but maybe not so now. So if we have a Hilbert space like L square, so in which we compute energy norm, it is reflexive because it's Hilbert space. So the Newlyn ball is weakly compact, which means that from each bounded sequence we can extract a weakly converging subsequence. In this sense, so if we multiply by a test function, we have convergence of this series of integrals. And this I will notice by this half arrow. So this is to be distinguished from the strong convergence, and weak convergence does not give any indication on the point convergence, as you know. Strong convergence, of course, implies weak convergence. So we have this implication. And if you want to have strong convergence, you need to have both weak convergence and also the convergence of the norms, energy norms, for instance.
If you want, there is the
point. Yes, thanks.
The yellow.
And which one to...
No, you cannot switch the slides.
Yeah, so okay.
Sorry, the point.
So for instance, if I take a series of sine functions, it converges weakly to zero in this space L square of square integrable functions. But this is very different from the weak convergence. And so there is actually not weak convergence to zero. So this is why we have to distinguish between strong and weak convergence. So this is quite known. So we are basically using weak convergence when we do a functional analysis. We cannot go easily take the limit at a point. Okay, so let's start with second gradient elasticity. So these are the set of equations, you know. So we have the constitutive law. So capital E will be the strain, symmetrical strain. So I'm focusing on small strain second gradient elasticities. And we have here the strain gradients. And we have A, B, and C, which are the tensor for constitutive moduli. So A is a tensor of classical first gradient elasticity. B here is a second gradient elasticity tensor, and C is a tensor of coupling coefficients. So this is a kinematic, this is a equilibrium equation. Sigma is Cauchy stress, S is hyperstress, and we have some body forces. Here we use homogeneous boundary conditions, but we could easily generalize to non-homogeneous boundary conditions. So we assume periodicity. So we have here a direction of periodicity, which is along x1. So we have this also these dependencies. So we suppose that we exclude here the dependency on the macroscopic variable. We just include the dependency on the microscopic variable x1 over epsilon. We have some assumptions because we have to prove that this problem has a unique solution. So we have to generalize Lax-Milgram theorem, but I will not go into the details. So we can prove that there exists a unique solution, which is in this space. So H2, because we have to take second derivative, and zero, because we have homogeneous boundary conditions. So nil value of the displacement and its gradient on the boundary. Oops. Okay, so let's start with an unfolding method. So, and then next I will present a similar approach of homogenization, but with a method of oscillating functions. So this is defined on a epsilon periodic structure. So here is a picture in 1D, so alternance of material 1 and 2, and here the same but in 2D. So the basic idea of the unfolding method is actually to, it's very bad that this is truncated, because this is very important, is to replace a function which depends... Then we should remove this part. Yeah? Okay, so the basic idea is that we start from a function depending on just one variable, so capital X, spatial position, and then we split it, we unfold it to a function that will depend on two variables, so capital X, the macro variable, and capital Y, which is a microscopic variable. So we write, this is an unfolding operator, T epsilon of phi, which will depend on X and Y according to this relation. Here we take the integer part of this, which means that each position, its X1, is in between two different center of the unit cell. So for instance, this is one center N1 epsilon, and this will be N plus 1 epsilon. And then we have to add, of course, the microscopic information to decide where is the point inside the selected unit cell. So it will say that we have this N1 epsilon, which is this unit cell, and then we have this fluctuation, epsilon capital Y, which designates this microscopic position inside this unit cell. So this ID, actually, which is very easy to understand in 1D, extends, of course, to 2D and 3D. And this unfolding operator has some interesting properties. And I will focus on the case of multilayers as an application, but it is not restricted to 1D. We could extend it to 3D with some additional technical complexities. But here, it is interesting because we actually pile up in a periodical way layer of materials along a single direction, which is x1. So the application of the unfolding operator to function phi, depending on x1, x2, x3, will give you a function depending additionally on the microscopic variable y1 according to this expression. So this is a 1D homogenization problem in a direction perpendicular to the layers, and it means that we can actually start smoothly from 1D homogenization because it will give us the main mathematical tools and ideas then to move to 2D and 3D problems, but it will hide, 1D will hide one aspect, which is matrix, so linear algebra calculus that we will need in 2D and in 3D. So I will start basically from 1D and then extend these ideas to 2D and 3D. So what are the properties? So there are many. Just focus on the most important one. So we have this product, the product here of two functions when acted by the unfolding operator is a product of the unfolded functions. We have here this property, which is also important, and when we take the limits, these limits, so the weak limit and the strong limit, transform exactly in the same way by the unfolding operator. Now when we look for second gradient, so here, because we have the weak convergence in H2, so there exists a phi hat function such that actually the gradient of phi is not changed in the weak limit by the unfolding operator, but the second gradient of phi actually is changed by adding the second gradient with respect to the micro variable of a new function phi hat. And this will prove important when we compute the homogenized behavior. So this is again the second gradient elasticity boundary value problem. I assume a macroscopically homogeneous medium, which means that the material coefficients here, A, B, C, depend only on the microscopic variable, x over epsilon. So this is again the same properties. These assumptions used by Luc Tartar, but not for second gradient. He never looked, I think, at second gradient problems, but of course at first gradient problem. If we take the weak form of this problem, transform it by the unfolding operator, we get this relation here, which is an equilibrium equation, but in the unfolded form. Then we have to take into account this property, and this allows actually to rewrite this weak form with this new function u hat, which appears here. We can take the integral average over the period, so 0, 1. And when do we do this? We highlight the average, the volume average of the material tensors A, B, and C. Okay? Now we have to make some adequate choice of the test function, because V here is a test function, and the trick is to split it in multiplicative form into a function of x, so the macro variable, and another function which depends on the microscopic variable. And when we do this by integration by part, we are able to solve from this boundary value problem for the u hat function. So we have especially to take the average of this term and this term, and once we compute it from this differential equation, we insert it back into this relation. So I will not go into the details of the algebra needed this, but at the end of the computation, we get these two expressions here that we plug back into the weak form of equilibrium. And then finally, we have found our homogenized second gradient operator, or limit elastic behavior, in which here we highlight the homogenized first and second gradient material coefficients. So of course here it's 1D, so we have only three elasticity coefficients. which are in fact a combination of the average of the microscopic elasticity coefficients. And especially if we look at these coupling coefficients between first and second gradient elasticity, we have conditions to check whether or not it will vanish, to find conditions under which these coupling coefficients will vanish. If we have, for instance, two phases with constant coefficient, this will be by linear algebra just a combination of the material properties at micro level weighted by the volume fraction of the phases. So this is the first step. Now we have, so it's not only a mathematical proof of existence, unicity or convergence properties, it gives also a constructive way to build the material coefficients of a second gradient material. Okay, so now let's compare this with the method of oscillating functions, which was developed by Luc Tartar and François Murat, still focusing in a 1D situation. So this is our boundary value problem, so it's still the same, of course. If we look at the mathematical properties, we see that this term here, which is in fact the stress, so this is a Cauchy stress, so this is bounded in H minus 1, and because of the compact injection from H minus 1 into H minus 2, this term here, which I call K epsilon, weakly converges to a limit which I call K zero. And also we have that the second derivative, this K epsilon second, belongs to a compact of H minus 2. So we have some mathematical properties, and here I actually enclose, so this is of course not the lemma that was established by Luc Tartar under the name the Divrot lemma, because this is for first gradients. This is an extension that exists in the literature that was developed in the late 80s by Antonik and another author. So it says basically if you have a weakly converging sequence G epsilon to G zero in L infinite, which means that this is bounded, if the weak limit of the product of K epsilon, so this quantity, which is a stress, times G epsilon exists in L2 now. If the div, so this is the composition of the div with itself, so the second divergence, because this is what we will have actually in a 3D context, we will have the divergence of the divergence of the stress, which must belong to a compact of H minus 2. And then there is an additional condition that the curl of G should be zero. And in 1D, you can always express a function as a gradient of another one. So this is always satisfied. It's no more obvious to do it in 2D and 3D. And then the conclusion is that this quantity does not oscillate. So what does it mean? It means that it has a trace in some adequate subrelief space. Because if you do homogenization, for instance, you have a composite, so you will have an inclusion in the unit cell with a matrix, and then it comes to the question, do we have continuity or not, or certain quantities at the interface? So when we cross the interface, some components of the stress and of the strain will be continuous, and some other one will not be continuous. And the question is, what do we do with the components that are not continuous? Because then we cannot take the limit, even the weak limit is a problem. So here we have a condition on which certain quantities do not oscillate, which means that we can pass to the limit in this sequence. And then the trick is to express all oscillating components versus the non-oscillating components, because if we can pass to the limit on the non-oscillating components, then we can do it as well for the oscillating components, which will be on the left-hand side. So let me express this further. So what is the trick now? We express the second derivative here, which is oscillating a priori, versus those components which are not oscillating. And then we can take the limits. So I get here U0 second versus those quantities in which we have the volume average of the microscopic moduli 1 over B and C over B over the unit cell. And here you see that there is a term which is reminiscent of first gradient elasticity, homogenization elasticity, which is 1 over b, which you find here again. So when you express k0 versus u0 prime and u0 second, you find this 1 over 1 over b, which is actually the homogenized modulus of first gradient elasticity. So it is a harmonic mean of the microscopic moduli. So this looks simple because it is 1D, but in 2D and 3D you will have additional technicality difficulties because of the matrix format. So what do we do? Now we start from our equilibrium equation here, in which we replace u second by what we had before. Then we can pass to the limit. We reintroduce here the expression of k0 that we computed before, so this term here, and then finally at the end of the slide we get the homogenized equilibrium equation in which we identify here the first gradient, here the second gradient, and here the coupling coefficients between the first and second gradient elasticity. So this is a way that we can go to the limit with a method of oscillating functions. It gives the same result, you can check, as with the unfolding method. So we can be happy with that. It means that we didn't make mistake in the computation or in the mathematical assumptions. So now we will move smoothly from 1D to 2D and 3D. So it will be a little bit more involved. So this is a boundary value problem of, let's start from first gradient elasticity, because this everybody knows. So this is a boundary value problem here, with u the displacement, epsilon small strain, capital A tensor of elasticity, epsilon small strain tensor, with homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions. This is a weak form. So this tensor A, we just require that it is bounded, so it is in the space L infinite, so it converges as a series of matrices. So what is the main difficulty? Here you see you have two terms which are indexed by epsilon. So naively we could think that the limit of the product is the product of the limits, but of course this is wrong. You cannot do this. Even for a product of two weakly converging sequences. So François Murat and Luc Tartar introduce this Ziff curl lemma to pass to the limit in the sense of distributions, but here we are in a vector value situation of system of linear, so it is still linear, PDEs, and with constant coefficients. It was extended in the late 80s, again by Luc Tartar, for varying coefficients under the name of H measures. And this is actually the cornerstone, or keystone in English, clé de voûte in French, of the method of compensated compactness that was also developed more recently by other authors. And it has application not only in mechanics, but also in mathematical physics. Okay, so this lemma actually is very important, not only in mathematics, but it proves important in the theory of composite media, because we have to handle the product of two weakly converging sequences. So this function f epsilon of capital X weakly converging to f0, if for any function converging, so weakly star, because we have to deal with non-reflexive spaces, so when a space is not equal to its bidual, so that's one motivation for introducing this weak star convergence. And then the product, we are sure by this lemma that the product will weakly converge in L2, but it will not necessarily converge to the product of the weak limits. So this is one main difficulty. So it can be easily generalized to vector functions, and we have done the generalization to second gradients. That's what I'm going to present right now. So the condition is that F epsilon should weakly converge to F0, the divergence should be in a compact of H minus 1, and the G sequence here, so the test function should be the gradient of a certain function and should converge weakly to a function G0. Then we are sure that the limit of the product will have a weak limit. So the question is, under what condition is G a gradient? So the question, the basic question we are answering actually is, what components of the stress tensor and what component of the strain tensor do not oscillate? So which component will be basically continuous when we cross the interface between two phases in a composite material in the sense of traces of Sobolev spaces? This is a basic question. So let's look now at the structure of the tensor gradient of a function of x1 only. So we consider a function in 2D, so with two components, a function of x1, because x1, remember, it is the periodicity variable. The gradient can be written in matrix format like this. So we have to take the product of the stress, Cauchy stress sigma, with a gradient of capital G. And at the end of the line, we see that sigma 1,1 and sigma 1,2 may not oscillate. So this is the result of application of the Diverot lemma. What does it mean? It means that the traction, so this is a known result in statics, the traction vector does not oscillate. But it is a result, a mathematical result. It's not given a priori. So based on that, we can apply the Diverot lemma to find, so this is application of this, and then we have to extract the components which are not oscillating and put them in vector format. So the traction vector and this component of the strain does not oscillate, so we can prove this, but by duality, the complementary components, so E11, E12, and sigma 22, are likely to oscillate. So I'm not going to show the proof, you will get the slides, I'm sure, so you can read this in a quiet manner. We can show that, so I changed the notation, epsilon 22 is the same as capital E22 because it's a small strain. So this is a basic result we are using now to continue the computation. So what do we have to do? I start by writing the constitutive law in the frame of isotropic elasticity, and we isolate the non-oscillating stress variable here on the left, and the non-oscillating strain variable on the right. And what I'm doing is to invert this system to express the strain vector, so this variable here, versus the stress vector, which is here. And since this is not oscillating, all those terms also are in L infinite, so they are converging to the limit, I can take the limit of the product, and then I get this relation. And then what I do is just to invert this relation, and I will get the homogenized constitutive law. So if we invert this system, we just get the effective first gradient elasticity modulus for the homogenization in the context of first gradient elasticity. Okay, so let's now extend this to 3D second gradient elasticity, which is a topic of interest. So now we take a function depending on x1, which is still the periodicity variable. So with two components, we take the second gradient, which will have this form. We split here this vector. So this is the hyperstress, which has six components in 2D, six independent components, if I'm correct. We show by taking the product of S with the second gradient of this G function that, in fact, S111 and S211, so the two first components are not oscillating. So what is this, in fact? It is the double force, if we write the weak form, of second gradient elasticity. So again, it is consistent with mechanics. So here, I take from this paper of Antonik and Balinovic, written 20 years ago, the generalization of the Diderot lemma. So it is similar to the Diderot lemma for first gradient elasticity, just that we have to take the second divergence of hyperstress, which should be in a compact of H minus 2. And then we have to multiply it by the second gradient, because if it is a second gradient, then the curl is zero. Then we satisfy the assumption of compensated compactness. And then we can see, indeed, that these two components here are not oscillating. So again, we have to do some linear algebra. So we can show that these components of the second derivative of the displacement do not oscillate. So here we have isolated all non-oscillating components of both the second displacement gradient and the hyperstress. So what is the rule if we want to summarize? The strain component involving a first order derivative, so in the first direction because it's a direction of homogenization, and the component of the strain gradient involving a second order derivative do oscillate. And opposite to this, the strain components not including any first order derivative in the direction of homogenization do not oscillate, and the component of the strain gradient including at most one first order derivative in the direction of homogenization do not oscillate. So this is a way to summarize these mathematical results. So if we now go back to the mechanic formulation, so this is the weak formulation of second gradient elasticity over a composite including an interface. So it means that we have a jump of certain quantities. So if I take it in 2D to avoid tensor algebra, to make it simple, we get these two conditions that the bracket is missing. Sorry for that, I don't know why. The jump of sigma, so sigma is the hyperstress. Sorry for the change of notation. The jump of sigma at any point of the interface should be zero. So this means the normal jump actually should be zero, and the normal jump of small sigma, so Cauchy stress minus the first gradient of hyperstress, should be zero. So this is exactly what compensated compactness gives us. So hope we are happy to get the same in mechanical terms. So now to conclude this talk, the last 10 minutes, I will compare the unfolding method with the method of oscillating functions, if the chairman allows me. So let's start. I wrote appetizer because it was supposed to be before lunch, but now it's no more the case. Let's start with first gradient linear elasticity in 1D. So there is an equivalent formulation developed by Luc Tartar, which follows after some steps, which I will not show. So probably you will be more familiar with that. So the method of oscillating functions amounts to solve this unit cell problem, in which you prescribe the macro strain. So capital E is a macro strain, and then you have this fluctuation with this periodicity condition. So this admits a unique solution up to a certain constant, and then it's easy to compute the homogenized tensor of elasticity, which is written here. Okay. So in the unfolding method, now what we do is to start from the weak form of the boundary value problem, and we apply the unfolding operator. So that's why we have this u hat in addition, that we get by solving this boundary value problem, in which we can replace this derivative. So du hat over dy can be replaced by an arbitrary strain, macro strain variable, without changing the solution. So we write it like this, we integrate, and then after a few steps we get the effective first gradient modulus, which is the same as with the method of oscillating functions. So extend this to second gradient elasticity. Let's start first with unfolding method. This is the weak form of the boundary volume problem after unfolding. So again, we have the second derivative of a new unknown function u hat, which solves this boundary value problem with two boundary conditions, of course. And this actually can be split into two separate unit cell problems in which we prescribe, in the first one, we prescribe the macro strain. So this du over dx, we can replace it by a macro strain capital E, function of x. And this second derivative here, we can replace it by k, which is the strain gradient imposed over the unit cell. And since the problem is linear, in fact, we can split this into two separate unit cell problems. The first one is, so let's start with this one, in fact, because when k is zero, we get this problem, which is triggered by capital E, the imposed macro strain. And this problem here, actually, is when capital E is zero, so when we impose the strain gradient over the unit cell. When we solve these two problems, we just have to compute the sum of partial solutions to get the full solution u hat. Then we reinsert this into the weak form of the limit second gradient boundary value problem. And then after a few steps, we are able to compute the tensor of first gradient, second gradient, and the tensor of coupling between first and second gradient elasticity as volume averages. So this is the method that we are using, unfolding method. I'm going to finish to apply this to a stratified material. And we suppose that each layer has a second gradient constitutive law, like this one. So it is typically a problem in which we can just homogenize along the piling direction, which is x1. So by the non-oscillating function method, the trick again is to isolate those components of the stress and of the strain which are oscillating from the one which are not oscillating, and then to make some partial inversion in this system to express oscillating components versus non-oscillating components. And then once we have this, we can take the limit, invert part of the previous linear system. So we have again to invert it to get here the hyperstress versus the strain gradient. And then we get, at the end of the day, we get the set of homogenized moduli in matrix format. So by the unfolding method, it is probably less physical and more technically involved to get the set of homogenized moduli. So you there is a trick which consists of integrating this equation, so you get one order derivation less. Then you take the weak form, you apply the unfolding operator, and then I will skip most of the details of computation. You have to make some adequate choice of the test function in separate form as in 1D. And then finally, you get here the tensor of homogenized moduli, which are here and which are exactly the same as with the method of oscillating functions. So to conclude, the method of oscillating functions is in fact closer to physics because we express continuity conditions especially across interfaces, and this is consistent with continuum mechanics. The unfolding method is probably less physical, but it is faster to implement. Both methods lead to the same set of limit equations and also effective second gradient moduli, which is not so easy to guess before you do the computation. And also I presented this method in 1D homogenization. It can be extended to 2D or and 3D, and we have done recently some application also to piezoelectric composites, because here also you have the same problem, especially for composite. You have to predict the homogenized piezoelectric behavior of the overall composite. So thanks for your patience and attention.
Now we are open for questions. say, you get only second gradient effective behavior if you start with second gradient.
We start with a second gradient.
So if you start with first gradient models, you don't.
There is no surprise. You get only first gradients. But there are some degenerate cases which are interesting. If one of the phases has a pure second gradient without first gradient, or the converse. I didn't show it. Yes?
But in fact, in your method, you are stiffening the second gradient elastic component. So if you look at the material length of your material getting higher and higher, in fact, that's why you recover a second gradient at the macroscopic level. Because in fact, if you keep your length, material length of the same order as the unit cell, you will recover a Cauchy material macroscopic.
If we look at a posteriori, of course, you have to compute internal.
It's a kind of hidden assumption that you get stiffer and stiffer second gradient elastic coefficient.
Of course, you have to recompute afterwards the internal length to check the importance of the second gradient effect, which were present initially at micro level and how they propagate at a macro level. Yes.